Mother, do not cry for me. All of this is exactly how it's supposed to be.
I'm right here. Can you hear my voice? My life, my love, my Lord, my baby boy.
As they nail me to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be your will, to have your son and my son killed?
Whatever happens, whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you has become of me. This is not the end. I am making all things new again. As they nail me to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be your will, to have your son and my son here?
Whatever your eyes tell you has become of me. This is not the end. I am making all things new again. Whatever happens, whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you has become of me, this is not the end. I am making all things new again.
Wow, Jim, man, that song was so deep and meaningful, it's hard to gather myself. That's why we're here. And also, I want to extend a meaningful invitation to those of you who are parents with your children here. We take it seriously here in training our children that you would trust us with in being able to be the most Christ-like and knowledgeable kids on the planet. And we really are intentional in this, and we've gotten a big grand prize together, that stained glass window of Jesus, to help celebrate any of the children or the child that gets picked out of the hat who can memorize all the verses for the next month. And so I extend that invitation for you to come back and make Beulah your church home. The week before the crucifixion, Jesus entered into Jerusalem. And as he was coming into Palm Sunday, he knew that he had to walk towards that walled city. And as he was coming on Palm Sunday, the people were shouting, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Hosanna!" And they were laying down palm branches and celebrating that their king, the Messiah, was entering into Jerusalem. And through that climactic experience, Jesus was not disillusioned. You see, he knew what his ultimate purpose was and why he was coming into Jerusalem. The next day, he was at the temple, and the court was filled with scam artists, so to speak, those who were taking advantage of the situation, of the Holy Week. They were selling things for exuberant prices. They were price gouging, and they were just making money in God's house rather than making it a house of prayer. So Jesus turned over the tables and kicked them out and said, "My Father's house will be a house of prayer." And then again, the next day on Tuesday, he came back to the temple, and he was answering questions from the chief priests who were questioning his authority. The people recognized that Jesus was the Messiah. The people wanted him to be the king, but they had the wrong mindset for Jesus. They wanted Jesus to push back the Roman oppression and help the Jews to rise up and take back their city. But Jesus is Lord. They didn't recognize that he was necessarily their Savior. And so the Pharisees and the Herodians tried to trap Jesus with a controversial political question. And as brilliant as anyone could be to offer one answer to pacify both sides, because it wasn't time for a riot yet, Jesus answered, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." And then the next day, on Wednesday, Jesus was at a neighboring town in Bethany, and a woman came up and anointed Jesus' feet and body with some costly perfume that was fit only for a king. So prophetic and so real and so amazing. But yet at the same time, the same anointing was for burial preparation. Jesus knew that God had ordained him to be anointed and prepared for burial, that which would happen only a few days later. On Thursday, Jesus gathered his disciples together, and they had a traditional meal. We know it as the Last Supper. He had a meal together with them in Jerusalem, and then that evening he left the city and went down the Kidron Valley and walked up the next Mount of Olives into what you know as Gethsemane. And that evening, in the coolness of the night, he did what he always did in the evenings. He pulled away for a time of prayer, some private personal prayer with his Father, some conversation between him and his Abba, his daddy. And at that time, the Lord started weighing down on Jesus his will. And Jesus began to accept and not reject the will of the Father for his only begotten Son to go back into Jerusalem and to be crucified, to pay a sin, to pay the debt for all of the sins for mankind. And you see, Jesus wept, but he did not run. He surrendered himself to God's will and did that which only he could do. You see, we cannot pay our own price for our sins. This was Jesus's path to walk. There in Gethsemane, Judas would then come prepaid from the enemy to betray him And he betrayed him with a kiss. That was a common greeting at that time. And Jesus submitted. And then, as they took Jesus and questioned him before Caiaphas took and said, "We'll send him to Pilate." And Pilate then said, "He's a Galilean. He needs to go into that jurisdiction." And then King Herod sent him back to Pilate. And Pilate finally gave in to the people's will. The people wanted Jesus, not Barabbas, crucified. They could have released a murderer during that Holy Week, but Jesus was unjustly deemed to be crucified. So the next day, on Friday, our Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, the holiest of holy, thrice holy, never impure, took upon impureness. He was spat upon. He was scorned and whipped and mocked and even stripped down nearly naked. And then after a torturous beating over and over and over again, he had to bear his own cross and carry that over to Golgotha. And as they set that Roman torture device up and they had Jesus nailed to it, this method of execution was intentionally slow and excruciating. His death was the most painful death on the face of the planet at that time. He didn't deserve that. He didn't deserve that. And every time I think and reflect upon things that I've done wrong, I realize that's my sin. Jesus, you didn't have to pay for my sin. I did that. I own it. But yet, you've already paid the price for our past sins, the sins that we might be engaged in now, and even our future sins that we will commit. And so we're only left to say, "Lord, I believe that you have died on the cross and risen again for our sins. I believe in that." And I could only just weep and say, "Thank you." The next day, Saturday, Jesus has died. And the disciples pull away and lock themselves in a room, and they fall into a deep, dark depression. Their fearless leader, who never lost an argument or conversation, who always had the answer and had a worldwide vision to save the planet, has now died. It's like all of the teachings that Jesus had prepared them with through the last 3 years escaped their mind, and they really didn't even know how to look back upon the Old Testament scriptures and realize this is foreordained. This is to be. And then be happy. They just couldn't pull it together in the desperation of the moment. And so they experienced separation, so to speak, from their leader, their fearless leader. And now Sunday comes, and in Matthew 28, and a couple ladies have a privilege to run up to where Jesus was buried. Matthew 28, I'll read the first 8 verses and then turn to Acts chapter 1. Matthew 28:1, "Now after the Sabbath, it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, and Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, a severe earthquake had occurred. And an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it." That's really cool, by the way. "And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men." Verse 5, "The angel said to the woman, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he was lying, and go quickly and tell the disciples that he has risen from the dead.'" He is risen from the dead. He has risen from the dead. Jesus has risen indeed, and now we live in victory. Those of us who believe this story can now live in that same sense of a resurrected life. We don't have to be down and depressed and locked away and living a life as if Jesus is not king. He is our king. And therefore, we can walk in victory and in boldness, by the way. We're not to be shrinking back in a world that is trying to tear down a 40-foot cross in Maryland. We're not to shrink back and not send emails and call and pray and even show up and say, this ain't happening. This is our foundation. This is what we believe. And if you tear this down, you're removing the foundation from what America was established upon. The Christianity's belief that Jesus died on the cross and rose again. I find it not strange that the world is fighting against the very thing that is sustaining it. It's crazy. It's absolutely, it's like biting the hand that feeds you. You know? It's like setting yourself up for failure. Folks just don't know if they're trying to remove Christianity. They just don't know. Turn with me to the book of Acts and fast forward with me about 30 years. From this crucifixion and death and resurrection, the author Luke writes to a companion named Theophilus. And it's been 30 years, and he describes the life of Jesus to Theophilus. It's called the Book of Acts. It's a historical account of what Jesus did. It's not everything. I wish we had everything, but the last verse in the Gospel of John said if we had everything, it'd fill every bookshelf in every house on the face of the planet. There's just not room enough to contain all that Jesus said and did. But here in Acts, we'll read the first four verses for the first point, that is, the resurrection is convincing, and then we'll read another four verses for the second point, and that is, the resurrection is commanding. Number one, verse one in Acts chapter one. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus had began to do and teach. That's the book of Acts right here in our hands. Until the day when he was taken up to heaven. After that, he had, by the Holy Spirit, given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. To these, he also presented himself alive after his suffering. So you see, Luke, a physician, a doctor, starts at the very most important part in our history, the risen Savior. He's talking about right before he was risen and ascended to heaven. So the Holy Spirit gives orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. Verse 3, to these he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over and over in a period of 40 days and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. Here, it's proclaimed that we have many convincing proofs. During this 40-day period, the very most convincing proof that is recognized even by secular historians is that we have accounts from those who have seen Jesus. Jesus appeared to all kinds of people after his death and burial. Verse 3, we see that he is alive. In the Greek, that means continuously and continually alive. He will never die again. Jesus gives us an overabundance amount of evidence. Let's take a look at some of the examples, some of the eyewitnesses, some of the testimonies. In Mark chapter 16, we see some of these testimonies. I'll read it to you in Mark chapter 16. Listen. When the Sabbath was over, here in verse 1, was over, Mary Magdalene and the Mary of Mother Jesus and Salome brought spices to they that might come and be anointed by him. And if you skip down to verse 9, now after he had risen early on the first day of the week, he first appeared to Mary Magdalene, then who had been cast out from seven demons. She went and reported to those who had been with him while they were mourning and weeping. And when they had heard that he was alive and he had been seen by her, they refused to believe it. After that, he appeared a different form to them. And while they were walking along their way in the country, we talked about this on Wednesday night for those of you who are here, while they were walking through the country, verse 13, they went away and reported it to the others. But they did not believe him either. Verse 14, after he appeared to the 11 themselves, as they were reclining at the table, and he reproached them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they had not believed those who had seen him after he had risen. We see that Jesus appeared not only to individuals, but he appeared also to small groups. And we'll see here in just a moment in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, in verses 3 through 8, how he appeared to almost or over 500 people. Guys, this is significant because this kind of evidence with these testimonies holds up in the court of law, even still to today. People can be convicted of the worst sins based off of just two eyewitness testimonies. Someone can face execution or face life in jail or be exonerated from life in jail or these types, just based upon eyewitnesses. Let me read to you 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 3. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. And he was buried, and that he raised on the third day, according to the Scriptures. And that he appeared, here's our point, he appeared to Cephas, who was Peter, then to the 12 disciples. After that, he appeared to more than 500 people. And then here at the bottom, you'll see he also appeared to the Apostle Paul. This is absolutely amazing. All of these people actually saw Jesus after he had died on the cross. He was risen. Can you imagine how they were fumbling in what they were saying? Is that you? I saw you die, and now you're alive. Can you imagine how the witnesses were feeling at that time? Well, Doubting Thomas was one of those guys, and after seeing and touching Jesus' wounds, he said, and I quote, "My Lord and my God, my Lord and my God." And then the Apostle John, 60 years later, wrote this, and it's recorded in the first letter called 1 John. He writes this, "What was from the beginning," referring to Jesus, "what we have heard and what we have seen with our eyes and what we have looked on and touched with our hands concerning the word of life," that is Jesus, "and the life was manifested, and we have seen and testify and proclaim to you this eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested to us, what we believe and we have seen and we have heard, and now we proclaim to you also, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship was with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ." So John still believed in the resurrected Jesus even 60 years later. You know, he was the last man standing. He was the last disciple alive. The rest of them had had either their necks stretched or cut in half or stretched or just torturous, you know. All kinds of different folks tried to make the disciples recant their belief or die, and they died for their faith. Isn't that enough evidence for us to say the disciples, all in unity, all were willing to die for their faith? And then John was later boiled in oil. Come on. Who of you, if you were put in a pot of some kind of vegetable oil and they turned, you know, it up and it got hotter and hotter and hotter, when would you recant your belief in Jesus? Or would you stand strong? Would you stand strong? We're in a day and age in our country that we must come to the place in our life and in our faith and even tell our children, guys, if I'm put in a bucket and boiled, I'm staying there. I will not recant my faith because Jesus is alive. It's a fact. There is no way that you can recant that. Even if you said that you recant, it still doesn't change a thing except for the fact that you weren't a good witness at the moment. Listen, guys, we're in a place in our life where we have to be vocal about our faith. Otherwise, what's happening around us is going to continue to encroach upon our Christian liberties. Don't ever back down. I want to say to those of you who might have trouble believing in the resurrected Savior, for those of you who might be here, or those of you who might later view online, if you still have doubt like Thomas, I understand. None of us were there, and we are believing by faith that this happened. We have eyewitnesses, we have the evidence, but it's still hard. How can somebody else die for my sins? It's hard to comprehend. I mean, I understand this. But listen, it truly, truly happened, and it's real. And since it's real, we have to believe it. And what Jesus said is true. even the secular historian, Dr. Paul Meyer, professor of ancient history at Western Michigan University, quoted this, and I'm quoting him, the documentary evidence for the resurrected Savior Jesus Christ is better attested than some events in history just 50 years ago. We have more eyewitness evidence than that Jesus was raised from the dead than for the death of Alexander the Great in Babylon. I wish they'd change his mind to Alexander the Horrible. But nevertheless, even this secular historian is saying that Alexander the Great from 323 BC doesn't have as much documented evidence and eyewitness evidence to believe in him than it does Jesus. I'll finish his quote. It says, or than we do for the famous Julius Caesar. And so we have more evidence that Jesus Christ died on the cross, completely died, dead, all right, unconscious, gone, in the tomb for 3 days, and then that he resurrected and people saw him. We have more evidence for that historical event than we do for Alexander the Great and Julius Caesar. Someone who hasn't come to the place where they are placing their faith in Jesus, but is educated enough to see the evidence, has admitted that. But it takes more than just admitted that Jesus was God in the incarnate body. You have to place your faith in the event and that Jesus' blood paid for your sins. Listen with me. Are you convinced yet? The resurrection is convincing. Point number two, the resurrection is commanding. And this is our part as believers. The resurrection commands us to be filled by the Holy Spirit and to be a witness. Let me prove it to you in verses 4 through 8 in book of Acts. Acts chapter 1, verse 4. Gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there in Jerusalem. Wait, verse 5. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So they were commanded to wait and be baptized by the Holy Spirit. That is, to be filled by the Holy Spirit. Skip down to verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, both in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest parts of the world. Sometimes when I just drive through Orlando, I feel like I'm in the remotest parts of the world. God has seriously brought the world to us. We can witness to a neighbor, and it's just like witnessing to someone in a different country. We live in an amazing day and age. We are commanded here to receive power from the Holy Spirit. How do you do that? It's very clear in the book of Ephesians. Let me read it to you. But the Ephesians chapter 5, starting in verse 15, therefore be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time because the days are evil. So then do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. To be filled with the Holy Spirit is not a suggestion, it's a commandment. We are to do that. And when you do that, you will be one who is joyful, thankful, and submissive. That's what the text says. Now you see, the Holy Spirit's part in your life when you believe in Jesus Christ is that he seals the believer. You're once saved, always saved, sealed, okay? When that happens, it's a done deal. You receive wonderful gifts from the Lord. You receive an eternal home. You can never, ever doubt your salvation. Well, you might doubt it, but it's still real. But here, the second part of the Holy Spirit's part in your life is to be filled. All who are saved are sealed by the Holy Spirit. But here's the sad part, but not all people are filled with the Holy Spirit because they have not yielded, okay? You haven't yielded some parts of your life, and it's like a barrier. Remove the barrier and experience all that God has for you. Today, we have a problem in America, and that is powerless Christians. Those of us who try to get through this world on our own two feet, in our own strength, the Bible says it's not by might nor by strength, saith the Lord. We need God's power and his ability and his strength to be able to be filled by the Holy Spirit, to say the right things at the right time, in the right manner, in the right way. He'll lead us to the right places. Lord, I pray you'd send somebody to Maryland to talk to the right people, to get in the right legislation, to talk to those who are suing, you know, the state and the county, to just kind of diffuse that situation. And may you be Lord, Lord of all. We have to understand that we as Christians, if we truly believe in the resurrected Savior, that we cannot just believe and not belong to Christ. Christ is either Lord of all or not Lord at all. And so if you really truly believe in Jesus, I'm making a case today that you will, according to the scriptures here in the book of Acts, you will be my witnesses. Jesus said in Acts 1:8, be my witnesses. Be my witnesses, even unto death, the Bible says. And so if it's worth believing in, then it's worth believing in all the way. Make up your mind, church. Let's make up our mind to be all in, because Christ was all in. Christ was all in. There was no holding back. Man, I'm so thankful that he accepted that. So now you see that the evidence of the resurrection is both convincing and it's commanding. It's commanding us to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Put yourself aside, all right? Forget about your desires and your wants. It's not worth it. It's not worth having something in between you and the Lord. Just put it aside. Put yourself in the rightful place, and that is underneath the Lordship of Jesus Christ. If for some reason this evidence that we have portrayed today and I've expounded upon today is not convincing enough, then there's something that you would have to believe in. You would have to believe in an ulterior theory, something like the impersonation theory, in that Jesus wasn't really Jesus when he appeared to all these people during these 40 days after the resurrection. You would have to believe, like this theorist says, somebody was impersonating Jesus. Guys, that's easy to refute, because the disciples were even reluctant to believe it was Jesus. It was hard to convince them, but he appeared to them and he showed them his wounds. They saw it for themselves. They believed. They believed. And even Jesus took and went into locked chambers behind closed doors and appeared to them. They believed. And so you can go through all the 5 or 6 or 7 ulterior theories for the resurrection to try and excuse it away, and you'll find yourself not standing on any solid ground, but yet you'll have to come back around and say, you know what? All of these appearances attest to the life of Jesus, and it's carried through the centuries, and now I'm going to have to come to the place in my life where I believe in him. And I'm going to ask you today that if there's never been a point in your life to where you have said, Lord, I believe that you died on the cross and rose again for my sins. Today is the day, not tomorrow. Today is the day to place your faith in Christ. It really is. We're not promised another day. We really, really aren't. And I pray that maybe, if you fall underneath 1 Corinthians 1:18, the Bible says, for the word of the cross is foolishness for those who are perishing. If you say to yourself, this is just foolishness, this is hard to comprehend. Verse 21 says, God was well pleased through the foolishness of preaching a message to save those who would believe. And so if you would take that step forward in your heart and mind and say, Lord, I believe that you died on the cross and rose again for my sins. Please save me. This could be the best day of your life. This could be the day that changes everything. Can I give you a simple example? I was in Bible college and I had heard something that I felt was kind of crazy. If you listen to Beethoven while you study, you'll remember things better. Boy, did I need to remember some things. As I study in late, I'd go eat supper with my family and then go back to the library and study late into the evening, into the night, into the morning, and And as there was some conversation in the library that was kind of keeping me from focusing, I put earbuds in, and my family had downloaded Beethoven, so you know how that family sharing thing works. Oh, okay. Clicked on that. Guys, I'm just saying that when I started listening to some soft, wonderful classical music behind while I was reading and studying, I can tell a difference in my effectiveness in getting good grades and being able to study better in less amount of time. It just worked better. It took me a while to stumble upon that belief, but I know in my mind that there was a change at that point in my life, in my study life. That's simple. But if you would simply think to yourself, if you don't believe, this could really, really change things for the betterment. Oh my, to be sealed by the Holy Spirit, to be filled by Him, there is no better life than that which is in Jesus Christ. Stand to your feet if you would, please. And I'm going to ask that if you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, that today might be the day. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Let's pray together. Lord, if there's one here that's never been saved, may they say this prayer, simple prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross and rose again for my sins. Please save me. We're going to pause here for a little while and listen to a wonderful song. And if you've made that decision, I want to be congratulating you now. If you still need to make that decision, we're going to give you some time to do that. You can make that decision where you're at, or you can come forward. You can call me later. Come by the office. It don't matter. You can do it however you want. It's your heart and your life, and I encourage you to give it to Christ.
Oh, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Oh, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Oh, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Oh, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loved.